further ado, may I please welcome Ms. Pierrette Raymond.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Woo! What a day!
Yes.
Wasn't it good?
Yes.
I had a question. I was asking a few of you. Did it meet your expectations of what you thought today was going to be?
Yes.
For some, did it exceed your expectations?
Yes.
If we didn't meet your expectations, we'd love to hear from you, because we purposely did not reveal everything we wanted to share, because then we get caught up in the, oh, I know what they're going to talk about. I don't need to go to that. And then you make a decision that you don't show up. So congratulations for showing up. I'm very excited that you're all here. You're all still here. I was like, I'm the last one of the day. I wonder how many people are going to leave. But you know, we couldn't miss Sue, so we had to be here. So my role here is just to tie this all together for you, because you have lots of ideas. Judy's giving you some great insights. You're probably thinking about, what am I going to do about my money, about my debts, my future, my goals? And Diane talked about relationships. For some of you, it went way over your head. You're like, what was that? But I'm going to ask you to do something with that during my presentation to help you get over that. And it was really insightful, even for moi, and when she put me on the spot, that was wonderful. You need to be heard. What the heck was that about? Maybe I do need to be heard, so hopefully I'll be heard here. And then with Sue, what's really great about what Sue shared, it kind of pushes us a little bit, right? It's like that, you know, you want to know a little bit more, but I'm not sure if I'm ready. I know Caroline and I were looking at each other a couple times going, whoa. Whoa, I don't know if that's for moi, but it might be for her. So all this to say is my role here is really just to simplify things. I'm really good at simplifying things when things are chaotic, when things are overwhelming. Kathy's like, yeah. I can help you bring it back to what really, really matters and what's most important to you. So that's my role here, because you've got a lot of good ideas. You've got a lot of great insights. So what do you do with it as you leave? What are you going to put more focus on? What are the things that are not going to be important? So I really want to help bridge that gap for you, so when you leave, you can focus on what you want, what's best for you. So for those of you who don't know who I am, there's a lot of new faces here. I am the woman behind 1-800-GOT-JUNK, but the man behind 1-800-GOT-JUNK is here. My husband and I started 1-800-GOT-JUNK almost 17 years ago. We were franchisees number 5, so it was the very first year they started franchising, and that was quite the experience. My background is psychology and education. I never grew up saying I wanted to be in the junk business. Let's just get that clear. I was never, even when he said, why don't we start a junk removal? I had another business, a home-based business. The kids were young, and I was doing really, really well. So I said, Neil, Luke, if you want, and he was working in the mines. I'm from Timmins. You guys know where Timmins is from? I'm a northern girl. So I said, if you want to go back to school or start a business, you can. So that got him working, you know, thinking all that through. And it was after we went to a trade show in Toronto looking at different businesses that he pulled out this magazine. It was a small business magazine. And Brian Scudamore, who's the founder of 1-800-GOT-JUNK, was in the small business magazine. He was standing on a pile of junk, and he was promoting this new business. And I said, that would be a great business. He had a little star next to him. I'm like, junk. Junk? I don't want to work in junk. He's like, but everybody has junk, and it'd be a really easy business. I'm like, well, I don't know if I want to be the junk lady. So as I read the article, it's like, we're going to put some standards in an environmental piece. You know, people want to be more environmentally conscious. We're going to revolutionize something. So I was like, all right, I can do that. And he thought it was a great idea. So the moment we got back home, called them, hit it off. Within 6 months, we had sold our home in Timmins, bought a house in Ottawa, uprooted our family. My kids were 3 and 6. My mother-in-law hated that we did that. She's still sad about that. But we needed to do what we needed to do. And through the years, you know, business is business. Lots of stories there to share with you. It wasn't until Mom got really sick in 2007 from cancer that I really started paying attention to where we put our focus, where we put our time and our energy, and what we say really matters. I was in the hospital with her for 10 weeks.
I left Ottawa to go be with Mom because I promised her I would be with her until the end. I thought she had a couple of days. She lived for 10 weeks. And I ended up living in the hospital with her, by her bedside, eating hospital food, showering at the hospital, doing my laundry at the hospital. And my brother and sister who lived there only came for an hour a day. And I saw it in all the other families, because we'd all meet at night. That was the year the Senators made it to the finals. So we were in the family room, and it was always the same people who were there. And after Mom died, I said, I want to go back to school. I want to study death and dying. I want to study bereavement. I want to understand what I'm going through, but I also wanted to understand what others were going through. So that's what I did for 4 years. I went back to school, studied death and dying, studied bereavement, even went down funeral services. And then one day we had a job on the 1-800-GOT-JUNK schedule. It was a woman, recent widow, and she put in their notes, I'm moving to Victoria, I need 1-800-GOT-JUNK to come and take my stuff away so I can put my house on the market and move to Victoria to be with my sister. So I told my husband, I said, you know, I think she's a new widow. I think I'd like to go sit with her and maybe help her. We had moved probably that fourth time at that point. We did the whole upscale the house, and then we had this big house at that point. And I said, I left you to move into our new home. forgot what I was going to say. Where was I? Right, so thank you. So I said, I'll go meet with you. So we did the estimate together. I sat with her, and it wasn't that she had a lot of clutter, but she needed some help sorting her stuff before we could list the house on the market. So I said, well, you know what, I can help you with this. And as I was talking to her and we did the walkthrough, she says, you know, she told me that not only was she a recent widow, she lost her mother and father-in-law the year before, and she was the executor of all three wills. Anybody here been an executor before? She had three recent and now a recent widow. She thought 1-800-GOT-JUNK was going to come in and just take everything out, and then she could list and be gone. She just needed to get out. She wanted that fresh start. So I said, well, I can come back and help you. I'll come back and help you. I'll do the one-on-one with you, and we'll get the house ready. There has a few little things we needed to fix. We'll help you with that. Sorry, I'm going to take this off because this is going to vibrate. And she said, you know what? I think I can do this on my own. I said, okay, here's my card. Didn't even have a business at that point. I just knew I needed to do that for her. But I did write on a card my name and my phone number. And a week later, the phone rings. It says, I need your help. And she became my first client to my second business, Moving Forward Matters, which is now a business that we help families and seniors downsize and move. But we also help declutter and organize. So I've been in a lot of stuff. Like, I see what your closets look like. I've seen that. I've seen what your basements look like. I know what your garages look like. If your car's parked outside and it's not in the garage, I know what's in there. And I had that too. You know, we had the garage door open, and my husband would have stuff in there, and I'd like, just close the garage door. And then I want my garage, so just, you're going to have to clear up stuff. So all this to say is I'm really going to... My role here is really to help you determine what matters to you, what's most important, the physical stuff, the emotional stuff, and the psychological stuff. Are you game for that?
Yeah.
You ready to go? All right, so where do we go from here? So today we talked about relationships, we talked about money, we talked about sex and intimacy. How does that all relate to your life? Right? What does that mean? So by the way, you all have a handout in there if you want to pull that out. All right, so where do we go from here? Most of you are going to determine what's most important for you based on a couple of things. What would it be for you, for example? Where would you put your most focus on something? Anybody want to just kind of blurt out a thought, an idea?
What was the question, sorry?
Where do you think you were going? Where would you...
Time for myself.
Pardon?
Time for myself.
Time for yourself. Okay, so a need. So there's a need there for money.
Yes. Purpose, like what I'm meant to be doing. I can't figure that out.
But where would you put your priority? So, for example, a hunger to know? Maybe a hunger to know? Because you want to figure that out.
Yeah.
I don't have the answer. I need the answer.
I need to channel what I into something that's productive.
Okay. Any other things? Yes, Debbie. So what would be the priority behind that?
I got a phone call from Revenue Canada. I got to find all the rest of my paperwork.
So an outside pressure?
Yeah.
Maybe a should?
Oh, big should.
A big should? Okay. Anything else?
Focus?
How about a frustration? Talking, you know, hearing Sue talk about sex and intimacy, I'm proud to say we'll be married 25 years this year. Woo! We've been together 35 years. Now he's going to be put on the spot. Ian's like, all right, buddy, here's your turn. Woo! And sometimes it's dissatisfaction, right? I'm fed up. I gotta do something. I gotta change something. Sometimes we need variety. You know, she's talking about variety. Some of our ideas, like Caroline and I went, whoa. That might be a little too variety for us. But at least be curious about it, right? So, or growth. I think many of you came here today because you feel it's your turn to say yes to you. Or your turn to say yes to your relationship. Your turn to say, it's my turn to invest in me. Does that make sense? But what stops us from that? I'm not going to fill this in. But what stops us from that?
Ourselves.
Tolerations. And for those of you who are my clients in this room, because I do private coaching as well, is we all have these little nagging tolerations, right? These little things that are we're just putting up with. Now the things that are, it could be the clothes in the closet. And you all know that we wear 20% of what we own 80% of the time. And if you want to put that statistic to the test, all the clothes that are hung up in your closet, turn the hangers all the same direction. As you wear something, launder it, and put it back, turn the hanger around. I've never had anybody say that. Well, you pick up the one off the floor and say, did I wear this yesterday? All right, I'm putting it back on. For some. Right. Or it's what you are wearing since it's on the floor. So you can test that statistics by just looking at what are you really wearing. You're always going to gravitate to the things that you love the most, that you're most comfortable with. Like, I love this dress. I'm so comfortable in this dress. You'll probably see a few videos of me online in this dress. You're going to keep seeing me in this dress. I love this dress. Do I have a problem with people judging me about this dress? I don't care. I love this dress. I would wear it every day if I could. All this to say is we have toleration. So what are they? So they could be that extra clothes. They could be the debt, right? They could be that nagging, I gotta get control of this. It's eating me away. I gotta get control of this. It could be, you know, with what Diane was saying. You know, there's a relationship between us here. Something's not right. Let's stop putting it aside and let's start focusing on it. There's tolerable tolerations, right? There's the ones that are there every day, kind of little nags, these little naggy feelings. Like even if you just do a walkthrough of in your house in your head right now. Well, we are. But just do a quick mental walkthrough and walk through your front door into your dining room or whatever room comes first. And stop and look around and say, what is already in this space that I know I don't use, I don't need, I don't want? That's a toleration, right? There are some tolerations that we get to the point where I am fed up. It has to go. And in my line of work, working with seniors, working with individuals going through lots of transitions and crisis, people wait for a crisis. And then it's hard. And then making decisions about a toleration is forced upon you. And when we're working with families who have seniors and there now is a crisis and they have to sell this stuff, they have to go through mom and dad's stuff, and it's all on their shoulders, it's no longer the same thing. So there's tolerable tolerations, and then there's the ones that just you know. So I want you to take a few minutes and write down a couple of your tolerations. And I'd like you to think about what we focused on today, just on what we focused on today, on money and finances, on your relationships, and on your sex and intimacy and exploratory life that way. What are you tolerating? What are you putting up with? What is still in your life that you know it's time to let go? Is it the physical stuff? Is there stuff in your home, in the garage, in your office, on your desk that you're tolerating? And every time you look at it, you feel frustrated. It pisses you off. She could be a tolerable toleration. she's probably not one you're going to let go of anytime soon.
That's what I was thinking. My first thought is that that's what I tolerate is my family. Like, you can't not. It's always kind of bad.
I'll give you some strategies, and that's where we're going. So doing the tolerations exercise gets you to take the blinders off. Have you ever been with somebody who just knows everything? It's like they have these blinders on, and you try to talk to them, and like, no, I know, I know, I know, I know, I know. How can you be with somebody like that? Right? It's like, oh. So what I'm inviting you to do is take off your blinders and see what's in your life right now around your money, your relationships, your sex life, your life that you've been tolerating. Sex life. We have a good sex life, but I don't know about what Sue does. It's like, oh. I don't know if I could ever be a duckling.
Being the love basket. There you go. Batteries are included.
All right, yeah. What was that, cherry? What was it, pinkcherry.ca? You knew you weren't here. Write that down, pinkcherry.ca.
See, that's what you get for leading.
All right, so let's move on. So I really want to invite you guys to start looking at what's in your home, in your life, that you're tolerating. Because these are the decisions that you can start making decisions. These are the things on which you can start making decisions that are the easiest. Right? Because they're just those little naggy, tolerable tolerations. The ones where you're really fed up, that's when you need to call me, Judy, Sue, and Diane. Right? That's when you say, I'm fed up. I can't do this on my own anymore. Now I need some help. Now I need some support. But here's the thing. What do these tolerations do to us? How do we feel? What are the effects? So this is the part where you get to participate. Michelle, pick a color. You said blue, right? Anybody else like to pick colors specific for different exercises? That's a little, my own little OCD. Little? Pick a color. What color do you want? What are the effects of a toleration? So just look at your list. Stress. Stress. Frustration.
Guilt.
Keep going.
Guilt.
Anger.
Sadness.
Pardon?
Shutting off.
Shutting off.
Wait.
Yes, wait. Stagnation. Excuse my back, guys. I don't understand that one. Overwhelm. Overwhelm for sure.
Pain.
Who wants to live there? Caroline, I'm making the appointment. I'm coming to your house. I am going to take control of this. She's been asking me. She keeps saying, you got to come to my house. You got to come to my house. We're making the appointment. Will you say yes?
Yes.
Okay, good. But who wants to live here? If we're talking about living fully and reigniting your life and living life to the fullest, we only get one kick at the can. Why do we want to live there? Right? Time to do something. Time to take action. Time to make a decision. But where? How do you do that? Right? How do you go from here to what you really want? It was kind of rhetorical.
I'm just saying, why do we put up with, why do we tolerate?
I'm getting there.
Oh, sorry.
I'm getting there, and it might be a big smack in the head for some of you, and for some of you to be like, oh, it's so obvious. It's so simple. Right? Pardon? Didn't hear that. I'm not Diane. Diane would be like, So in your handout, I want you to put, what are the effects of your tolerations in those little arrows? Put down a couple. And the reason I'm doing this is the same reason, and I wish Judy had kept her post-it note, is it's the truth, right? And if we don't look at it, we won't do nothing. It's like putting that everything in a box, taping it up, putting it in the basement, and leaving it there. And just expecting... We've already worked with you. I got to tell you this story. One of the first years I was doing home transitions, I was working by myself at that time. I didn't have a team yet. A young mom called me in to do some decluttering of her basement. She was pregnant with her second child. She had a three-year-old. And she wanted to make the basement part of the playroom. So she had a beautiful space to make this a playroom for her children. So she calls me in. And I wasn't talking about tolerations then. I didn't really know what those were until I really started working with people and saying, why are you putting up with this stuff? So as I was walking down the basement, there was a full wall of boxes. There were 42 boxes, and they were all dated, and I think I might get the date right wrong, but they were dated 2020. Her father packed up all of his mother's stuff after she died, saying, this will be for my grandkids when they're 18. Yeah, yeah. What?
Well, I buy extra cutlery.
That's not this story. It's a very different story. She did not know how to open those boxes. She did not know what was in those boxes. She was afraid to look in those boxes. So she asked me, would you come and help me go through those boxes? Sure I would. We probably had a small table of things that she kept. There were Kleenex boxes. Like, he just dumped garbage in there. It just, he didn't know how to process the loss of his mother. So he packed it. How many of you have things from deceased loved ones in your home right now? They are the hardest things to let go because they bring with it guilt. I can't let that go because then I'm dishonoring my loved one. But in fact, you're living stuck. And she was so stuck. So when we went through those, she just became a whole new person. Because she was like, you know, I got all these boxes and I don't know how to open them and I need your help. We did it in 3 days. We took our time, small little sessions, not to overwhelm her. Went through the boxes, kept what she really wanted to keep for her and her kids, and just let go of the rest. But we all have something similar to that, right? Those little things that we keep out of guilt. I have another story for you. I got to keep an eye on the time. It's the first time I deliver this presentation. So I was doing a summer of organizing. How many of you have seen Summer of Organizing? I think I might have a few people here, Summer of Organizing. So a couple of years ago, I decided to record myself decluttering my closet, our kitchen cupboards, the basement storage area, and the garage. And the reason I do that is because not too many people want a camera in their house going through their stuff, right? So I said, I'll do it. First day of shooting, so I have my camera on my tripod. Start the camera, go through all the house coats. I had a house coat from when the kids were born. Not wearing it, keeping it, time to let it go. And then I pull up this dress. Not this one, another one. No, I like this one. So pull out this dress, beautiful blue dress, gorgeous blue dress. I loved wearing that dress. Kind of like how I want to, I love wearing this dress. I loved wearing that dress. And the last time I wore that dress was so good. It was I was doing a presentation in front of 500 people. I got a standing ovation. It was so cool. They were all my peers, so they all stood anyway, so it was nice. Felt good. Anchored happiness in that dress. I hadn't worn that dress in, I would say, 5 to 7 years. I had outgrown that dress. It was a size 6. I was no longer a size 6. So every time I walked past that dress, it would remind me of the size I no longer was. And then I would feel like a schlump-a-dump. And then I would start going through this, oh, well, maybe one day I'll lose the weight, or maybe one day I'll fit back in it. Maybe, anybody else have something in their closet like that? So here I am, right? I pull out this dress, and I'm like, I'm going to say the yes word, okay? I'm like, shit. The camera's on, smiling. I can turn it off because I'm not live. We didn't have Facebook Live then. Turn it off and just not tell anybody the story of this dress. And then I thought, that would be lying. This is the stuff you do with people every day. You're teaching them how to let go of their stuff. You have to be honest. So I kept the camera rolling, told them the story I just told you, and on camera I said, okay, Dress for Success is getting this dress because there's another lovely size six woman who's going to love this dress as much as I love it, and she can be gifted that dress. And I just let it go. And just let more stuff go. And let more stuff go. And that's the point, right, is we all have these things that we hold on for the wrong reasons. So how do you let them go? I'm going to flip the page because I want to be very respectful of time. We're going to jump right through to vision. So I think it was you, Judy. Was it you, Judy, that was saying, what do you want? You have to know what you want, right? Whether you want for your retirement, where you're going in the next phase of your life. So what's really important is this piece. When I ask people, what do you want? Most people go, well, I want some more money, right? I want money, and I want to have a good relationship, right? They've never said I want more sex. They might now. Maybe this crowd will say I want more sex. But if you don't know what you want, you won't know what you're going after. So a lot of my work is let's create a vision. So let's say we're working in the closet, right? We're working through a space. And I'll say, well, what do you want for the vision of this room? What do you want it to look like? What do you want it to feel like? Get out of your head. What do you want it to feel like? What do you want for this space? And then the person will get a vision. If not, we'll go online. We'll find something because we're dealing with the physical stuff. And through the vision, we can create that. But if you don't know what you want, everything stays in your life. And then we just keep adding and adding, and maybe that fits with what I want. Maybe that's going to make me feel good. Maybe that's exactly what's going to make me feel like the person I know I can be. When in fact, if you don't get clear about what you want, you're going to just keep accumulating stuff, ideas. We're getting there. We're getting there. It's a step by step. So the vision is, what do you want, need? Because Caroline and I were having a little chit-chat there about kids. I want this. I want this. Is it a want or is it a need? So vision has to be related to what you want and what you need. And if you're not even sure, do an audit of your life of what you don't want. Start auditing your life about what you don't want, what doesn't make you happy, what doesn't make you feel joy, what's keeping you stuck, what's giving you all those things that tolerations bring you. And then you can start making a list of all the things that you don't want on one side of the page. On the other side of the page is, this is what I want. This is my living fully want vision, right? This is my basic need too. Some of those things are just going to be, what do I need? Does that make sense? It sounds simple, doesn't it? I see some of you looking at me like, that's so simple. But how many of you are doing it? How many of you know exactly what you want in a year from now? How many of you made a resolution in January that you are no longer following, right? You thought that's what you wanted, but in fact, it's not. So to get clear about that, we're going to get into that. We were talking about, you know, we need that alone time. We need that quiet time. I'd like you to put on your vision sheet, you'll see the vision area there, three things. Based on what you experienced today, it could be money, it could be sex and relationships, whatever it is for you, what do you want that you don't have right now or don't want? Does that make sense? Did I say that question properly? What do you want? It's in the handout, page 2. What do you really want? What really matters? What's most important to you? What's that vision? When I do this exercise with clients, we write out everything that they want in all areas of their life. Health and wellness, money and finances, family and relationships, fun and adventure, community and philanthropy, business and career. We create this big vision. They're really excited, like, woo, this is awesome. This is what I want. And I say, well, why don't you have it? Too much work. You know what I mostly get? And you got to get really clear about it. Oh, I'm going to grab a different color. I got the color. There's a fear. There's a fear. A fear of being judged. A fear of not doing it right. A fear of being too old, a fear of being too young, a fear of what could go wrong, a fear of what could go right, a fear that it's too much work, a fear. It's a big fear. We all have fears, and they keep us stuck. So how do you deal with fear?
But are you saying that, are you identifying want and need with fear?
I'm identifying that if this is what you say you want, right, and most people can get really clear about what they want, and then I'll ask them, why don't you have that now? What's preventing you from having that now? And when we dig down, it always comes down to fear. And it's not the fear of, I'm going to die. You know, not the mortal fears. It's those little nagging fears that we hear every day that keep us stuck, right? Judgment, too old, too fat, too skinny, too young, too, and not enough. There's either the too much, or the two, or the not enough. So how do you fix this? This has been a revolution for some of the women that I've been working with recently. Curiosity. Because if we go into any situation, with anything that, you go back in all of your notes from today, from Judy's conversation, Sue's, and Diane, can I just finish my point, and then I'll come to you? Thank you. If you go in going, I know, that's where that fear can come back because we create the story of what can happen. Instead, I'd like you to go into curiosity and say, what could go right? What is the opportunity there? Everything, I would love for you to start living your lives in curiosity. Be curious about everything. I'm curious about it now, Sue. Doesn't mean I'm going to take the jump yet, but I'm definitely curious. And that's why I asked you about your expectations today. We set expectations on everything in our lives, and we let ourselves down because we go in knowing what we already don't know. Like, we go in knowing what we think is going to happen, so we make a decision, we create this little story in our head and say, that's what's going to happen. And it doesn't happen. So instead, be curious. You had a question or a comment? Absolutely.
You might do it wrong. It might not be the right thing. You don't know until you try.
Right. So just to reiterate, so for those of you that didn't hear or for the recording, she said sometimes you go in fear of not knowing what will happen, but you go in curious and doing it anyway. I'm paraphrasing, but is that what you said? Right. And that's what I've been seeing, and I know it sounds so bloody simple. Like, this chick up here is talking about curiosity. Like, seriously, I invite you to be curious. I invite you to look at what's in your home. I invite you to look at what's in your life. I invite you to look at all aspects of your life with curiosity and see what opens up. I promise you, it's super exciting. I'd point out a few people, but I would put you on the spot, yeah.
For me at least, when I find myself getting caught up in that and I do tap into my curious side, I think
You know what curiosity is? It breeds courage. If ever you're in a position where I need to be courageous, go into curiosity. Every day I do this Facebook Live call, not every day, most days I do a Facebook Live called Which Would You Rather? I do this for a couple reasons. One, I want to get better on camera. I want to stop being afraid of pressing record. It's really that simple. The other side of it is I want to talk about what's important, what's our priorities, where do we put our time and our focus and our energy. So I do these Which Would You Rather questions. Would you rather this or this? So it gets you thinking. Every day I look at that phone and I'm like, I don't want to press record, because then I start playing in the fear. Something can go wrong. I'm going to look stupid. I'm not going to say it right. I'm going to mumble my words, blah, 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 blah. Then I have to remind myself, I need courage. So I got to get curious. Just do it. Just do it. Press record. See what happens. None of my fears manifest themselves. Most of the time, they're okay. Sure, they're not all perfect. They're not going to be perfect. That's not the point behind them. So how could you now move into courage and by being curious? Does this make any sense? All right. The second one is clarity of purpose. Working in clutter has really solidified this. Clarity of priorities. We lived in a big old 3,000 square foot home, big yard, in-ground pool, fully finished basement, awesome, awesome house. And 2.5 years ago, I told my husband, I said, this house is killing me. It's too big for us. The kids are no longer home. I'm lonely. We're only using a few rooms. Why are we keeping up with the Joneses in this huge house? Well, we don't need it. So we got clear about what we really wanted. We wanted to move to the country. We wanted a smaller bungalow. I hated cleaning that house. It took us 3 hours every Saturday morning. 2 people, 3 hours to clean that monster. Beautiful home, but we outgrew it. It was no longer a priority for us to have the house where the kids would come over, right? We had lived that chapter of our lives. We needed to reassess our priorities. We had to get really honest with ourselves and saying, why are we keeping this house? Is it just for show? To show that we have money? Like, why are we doing this? What do we want? So we got really, really clear about what we wanted. Now we live 15 minutes at an extra drive, country road, cute little bungalow on 44 acres of treed land. We have our own trails in the back. We can go skiing. We can go hiking. It's awesome. So clarity of priorities is getting really clear about what matters to you, what's most important to you. So when I'm asking you to do your vision, I want you to say, what is really important here? You know what's the worst part of not having your priorities aligned? Regret. I've worked with 80, 90-year-olds, some 60, 70-year-olds who are not healthy, and when they tell me their stories of regret, if they could go back, they would want to say, what was really important to me? That's where I want to put my time, my energy, and my focus. So I get to be their messenger and invite you to look at your life and say, well, what do I really want? What's really important to me? Am I living that now? What's in my life? Right? So that you can reassess that. So on your sheet, just jot down a few things. What really matters? What's most important to you? Conmarie.
She says, keep only the things that bring you joy.
Yes. Okay. So very much an advocate of that.
Pardon me?
Very much an advocate of that.
Yeah, so that's a good philosophy.
Yeah.
Okay, but, for example, I'm at a point in my life where I have antiques that I don't really need anymore.
Right.
But they are beautiful.
Yep.
And I'm thinking that, but there's, in one sense, like, they bring me joy.
Yeah, what do you want for your home? What do you want for your life? Would you be better off selling them, gifting them to somebody else? Because it's not really something that fits with where you are anymore. Maybe it is. Mm-hmm. So are you getting clear about that so it matches that? Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And we certainly can have a conversation afterwards because there's really... Right.
In that sense, I don't really want to let go of it.
But what's the vision for you in your life?
With my husband, who is deceased. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's all those connections, those emotional connections to something.
Right.
And so you say, yes, it would be better if I didn't have it, because then I could have a less cluttered space. And that feels good. So both things.
It sounds like you're in a tolerable toleration position. I love them, but I know I could let them go. I love them, they bring me joy, but I'm not sure if I still want them. So you're in a place now where you get to be in curiosity and say, what do I really want? Do I really want to keep these? Because there are options for you if that's not what you want for your life. And then you can go through those steps. But it really is a matter of what do you want? What's most important? Donna?
To set up a plan where when the time comes that I am gone, that they know it's not guessing mom would have wanted me to keep them.
Right.
That we've already had those discussions so that I might enjoy it until my last day, and then they're free to sell it, give it away, whatever, or keep it if we've negotiated that. But I think that is that trying to have that clarity so that your family knows and you can enjoy right to the last minute.
Yeah, and you want to have those conversations with your loved ones long before you need to. And how much stuff do we need, right? How much stuff do we need? I want to share a story with you because I feel the energy is coming down a bit because we're talking a little bit more seriously here. I was working with a woman and we were decluttering her closet. And how many of you have a single sock problem? A single sock problem. Most people have a collection of them, right? So we walk into this closet, and there on the closet floor are three garbage bags full of single socks. Three garbage bags full. But we all know what happens with single socks, right? They run off and live happily ever after, and they never come home. So one of my tips for when people are saying, well, where do I start? Because when I do a presentation on downsizing, I answer three questions. Where do I start? Where will I go? Because people are moving. And how much will it cost? I always say start where it's easiest. Linen closet, sock drawers, not a lot of emotional attachment there, so you can start there. Then I usually lead into the sock story because we all have socks, single socks. All right, let's keep going because we're almost out of time. The next one is self-awareness. This is one where, as Carol Ann pointed out, you know, we're kind of just talking. It's like, how do you know what to decide on? Like, life is so like this, right? It's so busy. It's so frenetic. It's go, go, go. And depending on what stage you are in your life, if you have young children, it's even, you know, that stress on you is even far greater. So how do you slow that down? You need to take that time for yourself. I'm a big advocate of self-care. I'm a big advocate of timeouts. I'm a big advocate of really focusing on what matters most, and that's you. So I loved when in Diane's presentation is rather than blaming, is look at yourself. And a lot of times if we're looking at what's in our home, what we're holding on to, the things that are keeping us stuck, it's because we don't take the time to get clear about what matters most. We live in a world of shoulds, don't we? I should do this. I should do that. He's expecting this of me. She's expecting this of me. And then we forget that there's me. I had several women come up to me this morning in tears saying, I'm so happy to be here because I'm putting myself first today. And it's so important to do that because that self-awareness piece allows you to go back to this, live in curiosity, and live without regret. Because then you align what's important when you know what matters most, and that self-awareness gives you that opportunity to do that. Because we're running out of time, we won't jump into the exercise, but I will point out this. There's two things to this, the gift. The first thing is when you do that, when you sit quiet and you reflect and you look at what's important, some of you are going to pack up all the notes from today. They're going to be put somewhere in the other piles of paper. You're laughing because it's true, right? I would have liked to have our folders orange so they would stand out calling you. We went with white instead. But some of you are going to put this and put the folders, tuck it away, and not do anything with this, right? That's what some of you are going to do. I've been there, gone to conferences, leave, and think, I got all these ideas. I'm in the plane sometimes. I'm making all my lists. I get home, and life gets busy, and we don't even do anything with it. So I really invite you to do two things. One, keep the folder where you can see it, and for the next week, go through your notes, go through what you say is really important to you in your life, and start asking yourself if you're aligning yourself to that. Are you really making decisions about what really matters to you based on everything we talked about here today, just today? And then give yourself the gift of what you want. And at the same time, you're going to start seeing things about yourself. You're going to start seeing, I'm really good at this piece. You're going to start identifying some of your own strengths that you might not have noticed. I would hate for you to go through a crisis like Carol Ann had to go through to see your own strength. Because you all have strength, you all have gifts. So when you take the time to really get focused on what you want in your life, you will find that you will see in yourself things that you probably haven't seen yet. That's why our Women Living Fully group is so cool. Because we get to talk about stuff and we get to see, wow, that's really cool, I'm like that too. And then there's this whole awareness. And then you can start letting go of the stuff you don't want, don't need, and focus on the stuff that really, really lights you up. Make sense? All righty. Last piece. Empower. This is how I tie it all together. This is the alignment piece. Yeah, it's on its own page. So the empower is the P-O-W-E-R. That's how we align our vision, our priorities, and self-awareness. And I'm going to go through this really quickly. There should be a third page. May I see? No, not the... Yeah, it's right here. So it looks like this. So there's a circle with purpose. Starts with purpose. It says on purpose, organized wealth, energy, resolve. Oh, benefits. Pardon me. That one. We got it? Okay. All right, so the benefits. I'm going to just go put this in here. These all fit together. So purpose and passion. Last year I worked with 6 women privately. Every single woman was going through a major transition. And while we were working together, we were going through what they wanted in their lives, what was holding them back, going through all that, their tolerations and all that stuff. And when we got to the purpose and passion piece, and that was my which would you rather question last night, which is more important to you, having purpose or having passion? Out of curiosity, which would you rather have, purpose or passion? Who are my passions? Who are my purpose? Oh, good mix.
I can't separate them.
Some people say you can't separate them, but you can't.
I already have the
Looking for the purpose? When I look at this, I also look at your physical stuff. Because like I say, I've been in so many closets and basements and attics, and I got to ask, what's the purpose of that object in your life? Is it bringing you joy? Is it bringing you happiness? Is it fulfilling what you want, right? So that's how you can align with your vision, your priorities, and self-awareness, is how does this make me feel? Is this important? Does it have a purpose? And you can't say, well, maybe one day I can use it, so I'll keep it. How many of you have those items? Maybe one day, right? Or I paid so much for it, I need to keep it. So really breaking that down into what's its purpose and how excited do you get? Really get into the feeling part. That'll help you start making some decisions about this stuff. Kathy keeps going, yes, yes. Catherine.
Sometimes I like to watch Hoarders and know that I'm okay.
Touché. Who else watches Hoarders and go, oh, I'm not even close to that? Most of the time, thank you for that. Most of the time, people will call me and they're so like, I think I'm a hoarder. And then you go in their house and it's like, not even close. You just hold on to stuff. We all do.
Is that a challenge?
Pardon?
Is that a challenge?
Sure. Okay. Organize. So the organized piece comes with when you know the stuff that really, really matters to you and you're really clear on it, you can organize every part of your life. You can organize every closet, every basement. You can organize your finances. You can organize what you do in the bedroom. Because you're really clear about what matters. You're really clear about what's the purpose? Why are we doing this? And when you know your vision and your priorities, you can organize any space. And if you guys, you know, here's the funny thing. You can go on YouTube and get every single how-to on how to organize your house. True? Tried it. But until you get clear here and here, you keep holding on to the stuff. When we do this, and we hold on and we hold on, it's really hard to do this. Right? So you got to start letting it go. The wealth piece is abundance. And I don't mean too much stuff. I don't mean the overclutter. I mean we all have pretty decent lives. You know, we all have really good things in our lives. Yeah, we have the stuff that's not so good. But if you take the time to look at what you do have, and you can be in a wealth, you can be in gratitude. This wealth is really gratitude. Gratitude is such an important practice. I see many of you, what's that? I have 54.
One more.
I'm almost there. I have 5 minutes. No, you're saying two? What time is it? I took off my watch. All right. Energy. Here's another one. I'll wrap up real quick. If your stuff in your life isn't giving you energy, there are many things in our lives that just suck. And I'm not talking about people. I'm talking about stuff that sucks the life out of you. And if it's not bringing you joy, if it's not giving you energy, audit that. And finally, the resolve is just make a freaking decision. Just make the decision. I don't want this anymore. I'm not going to keep this anymore. It's time to let it go. And stop caring what people think. Free yourself of that. Do what matters most to you. Do what's important to you and stop caring what people think. Live in power. Exclamation mark. And there's my presentation. Stop. All right, hi.
Pierrette Raymond. Yeah, just make a decision. I made a decision.
We have a panel now, right?
We have a panel. We're going to bring our speakers, Deanne, Judith. Sue's still with us, Pierrette. Take 20 minutes for Q&A. Don't go anywhere because we're going to have the draw. Okay, we got some nice gift baskets and things to draw for. So
Gotta bring the energy up.
So this is the opportunity.
There's neat music.
We're gonna open the floor and you can direct the questions.
Purpose, passion, organized, well done.
Is there something that you haven't...